Look at it. Gorgeous, isn't it? And to be honest, so much has been said about the Mini Moog and Bob Moog, or indeed Moog the company, so I'm not going to add anything else other than a quick guided tour and to say that the 1971 Mini Moog Model D defined everything thereafter. All right, it might not have been the world's first portable synth. That accolade went to EMS. But it was undoubtedly the world's first truly portable and playable synth. And it really defined the moment where synthesis broke away from academia and moved into the mainstream. The operation of a Mini Moog is brilliantly simple. The controller section gives you access to things like global tuning, glide or portamento time, and also has a noise oscillator balance for modulation. Well, we'll come to modulation later, but for now we'll move on to the engine of the instrument. This is the oscillator bank, where you set the range and waveforms of the three oscillators and where you have fine-tune adjustments over oscillators 2 and 3. There are a couple of switches to do with modulation, and again, we'll come to these later. But suffice to say that one turns on pitch modulation and the other one effectively removes oscillator 3 from the keyboard's voltage control. The oscillator bank is the first area where this instrument really shines. The three oscillators equates to power, and there's just something about the raw oscillator waveforms that exudes grunt. Here, we've set all three to a sawtooth wave, and just tuned oscillator 2 and 3 slightly sharp and flat to get that massive detuned effect. Of course, we can mix and match oscillator waveforms and octave selections. The level of each oscillator is then set in the mixer section. Or, if you want, you can turn each of them off. Even with a single oscillator playing, the Mini has balls, and it just feels so alive. It's almost as if you make a physical connection with the electrons buzzing around its innards. In this section, you can also introduce white or pink noise, as well as introducing an external audio signal. Now we'll come back to this in a bit because there's a lovely trick here that can turn the Mini into a sonic killing machine. But in the interim, we'll have a look at the section which really helped the Mini Moog sparkle, the filter section. The Mini's filter has been talked about ad nauseum, particularly when it comes to technical specs and debates as to whether cascading four filter block sections in series, each with a cutoff slope of 6 dB per octave and then creating a feedback loop with... I'm going to stop there. But seriously, we've been at parties where these types of things have been discussed. Right, it might have been a crap party, but this just indicates the level of discussion that Bob's ladder filter gets, even these days. Anyway, returning to the real world once more, as you'd expect, the filter section gives control over cutoff and resonance, called emphasis on the Mini. The filter contour amount enabled control over the filter envelope depth, and with regards to the actual filter envelope itself, you have three stages consisting of attack, decay, and sustain. Decay also doubled as a release via a button on the left of the keyboard. This also applied to the amplitude envelope. Finally, you had the output section, and as you would expect, this gives control over the final output volume, headphone volume 2, and also a 440Hz tuning reference tone. But what of the modulation potential, I hear you cry? Well, with the Mini, if you wanted to modulate anything, you had to give up the third oscillator, effectively turning it into an LFO and assigning it to pitch, filter, or both. Now to do this, we must return firstly to the mixer section and turn off oscillator 3. Then, we head back to the oscillator bank section, head to oscillator 3, and select low range. Our LFO waveform is then selected by the normal waveform knob, and having assigned it to pitch and filter via the red buttons, we turn up the mod wheel and choose the speed via the oscillator 3 fine tune knob. There are a load of tricks here that we can do, such as move the LFO into the audio range, and when we use this with the filter and remove any pitched oscillators from the equation, we start to move into serious effects territory. So that's the LFO, and while many people moaned about having to give up that third oscillator, the truth is the Minimoog is so ballsy that it copes admirably as a two oscillator instrument. Nonetheless, when you kick in all three oscillators and detune them, this instrument really does have an almost unrivaled power. And that's why on the Mini Monster, we decided to give the instrument the ability to apply independent LFOs to almost any of the main parameters. This way, there's no compromise. If you want three oscillators, absolutely fine. If you want a whole heap of modulation routings, absolutely fine. There are other shortcomings with the original instrument too. Early oscillator boards were hell-bent on going out of tune at every available opportunity, but in our opinion, these early boards were the ones with the fatter sound. Our Minimoog serial is in the 1700s, which means it's around the 700th made, and it has that early board. Its scaling across the keyboard range has never been 100%, and its tuning is precarious at best. It is not an instrument to take out live, and that's one of the reasons why we chose to model it, to try and introduce some stability into the sound of an early Mini and let everybody else share in its magnificence. One other thing that's important to realise with the Mini is that while the filter is indeed stuff of legend, cranking up the resonance or emphasis does attenuate the bottom end. Now obviously this is great when it comes to searing leads and blippy sounds and making something sit within a mix, but if you want bass that'll blow holes in walls, turn that resonance down. Now I mentioned earlier about some trickery with the external input, and this is where you can get some weapons grade bottom end. Essentially you take the high level output and route it back into the external input before setting the input level so that it's just on the verge of overloading. Then you take the low output and you send it to your mixer to cause it some serious pain. On the Mini Monster, this was one of the hardest things to model correctly, but we recreated this without having to resort to re-plugging any virtual leads. Just hit the feedback switch, turn the external input signal switch on, and adjust to taste. So there you have it, the Minimoog in a nutshell. Now whether you're a synth novice or a seasoned pro, there's just something about the sound of this instrument that is undeniably special, even after all these years. Testament indeed to the sheer musicality that Moog brought to the world at large.